Hi, my name is Adam LaRue. I am a faculty member here at LACM. I am part of the music business program. I teach a lot of music business classes. And it is my distinct honor to host an interview for Let's Talk Music tonight. So tonight, with Let's Talk Music, we are giving Michael Beinhorn here a honorary scholarship in his name. And so, in perpetuity, we'll have an opportunity to have a scholarship in Michael's name. So let me give you a little background on Michael. He's worked on records that have sold 45 million copies. He is only one of a handful of producers to have two separate recordings debut in the Billboard Top 10. In recent years, Beinhorn, Michael, has turned his attention to concerns facing artists today and producers, attempting to maintain their creative ethics and focus on the recording process. Is that right, Michael? He has been increasingly active in mentoring fellow artists and aspiring record producers. So, ladies and gentlemen, my friend Michael Beinhorn. Well, welcome.
Hi.
Oh, you should probably turn on your little mic thing.
Oh, I thought it was on.
Oh, there it is. Okay, here we go. So, I'm going to start out the way I usually start out my interviews. Where were you born, Michael?
I was born in Forest Hills, Queens. Mm-hmm.
Did you grow up there?
I did.
All right. It's the ghost.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Yes, I did.
Did you have a lot of music in your family growing up? Like, you know, did you a lot of music in the house?
Listeners, mainly. My mom was a classical pianist. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that was, a lot of music.
A lot of music.
Yeah.
What did you remember a lot when you were growing up as far as music? What was, besides the classical stuff, was there a lot, what classical stuff was in there, and was there popular music playing as well?
It was mainly all the staples, you know, like Bach, Beethoven, Mozart, Vivaldi, stuff like that. Uh-huh. And popular music, not a whole lot until the Beatles. My mom sort of discovered them, and then she started bringing the records home, and the world sort of changed.
Kind of opened up for you.
Yeah.
How old were you when you first started getting kind of your own taste in music?
I don't know, probably like 3, 4, something
really?
Like that.
That
it was pretty instantaneous. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah. And were you gravitating towards the classical music, or?
I liked everything.
Yeah.
Everything that I heard, you know. I mean, I was noticing that some things kind of moved me, and other things sort of rubbed me the wrong way. Right. I began to notice what it was that was actually appealing to me and what wasn't appealing to me so much. Mm-hmm.
What about classical music appealed to you?
Specifically, I guess the fact that it was melodic. In many cases, they're obviously repeating motives and things like mm-hmm. that. And also, there's really extraordinary dynamics. With some of the best of it, the dynamics aren't necessarily, they're not predictable, per se.
Okay, I think you have to do the microphone.
Okay. Hello.
Oh, no?
Okay.
Right. The dynamics were absolutely. How's that? That feels good. That's more.
Get up, address the mic, Michael.
Yeah.
So the melodic nature of the classical music.
It's all of it, really. It's
sure.
All the different variables, you know, starting to kind of like to understand like the tonal aspects of it. Like what each instrument was doing, which I mean, at that point, when you're that young and you're not able to break stuff down,
mm-hmm.
it's like a mystery.
Right.
The whole thing's like magic, you know, and the way things sound, and listening to Beatles records, because Beatles records don't sound like symphonic records, like concert music,
right.
You know, so you're kind of like, what's so different about like this than that? And you start to realize that there's something really extreme happening. That someone actually put something into the fabrication of the Beatles record.
like drums don't sound like a drum kit. Like they sound like something else. Like something kind of, someone kind of souped it up a little bit and did something. It's like, wow, that's kind of interesting.
When did you start learning? You learned a musical instrument, keyboard, right?
I took piano lessons for a little while, but really wasn't for me.
Right.
Like I never really fancied myself as being much of a musician. It was more like, it was just an interest in music and an interest in sound. I did study synthesizer, and I took, I studied modular, like the Buchla 200 series at a place in Manhattan.
So you grew up in Forest Hills.
Yeah.
Were you there during like the big Ramones, Television, Talking Heads, Blondie, you know, that kind of the, obviously the Ramones were from Forest Hills.
Yeah.
But were you in that scene?
No. That was before me.
It was before you.
Yeah, and I started coming to Manhattan and like going to clubs like as it was kind of phasing into like the second wave of punk bands that sort of amounted to like not quite as much, you know. So all the like bigger bands had come in like a wave before,
right.
And all the originators of that sound or that scene.
So fast forward, you're in high school. Did you go to college?
No.
So
I'm a very proud possessor of a GED.
Mazel tov.
Thank you. Gesundheit.
So after that, what did you do? Did you go right into being a musician and producer, or, you know?
I basically left home at 17 and couch surfed for like 3 years. And I was basically like a street urchin.
Really?
For all practical intents and purposes, yes.
Oh, okay. He's whispering sweet nothings in his ears.
I've always felt that way about you too.
How did you meet, is it Bill Laswell?
Yeah, well, I kind of, my taste in music kind of like diversified quite a bit over time.
Mm-hmm.
And I started to get really into a lot of weird European progressive music. And one day, my friend Fred and I saw these flyers all over the East Village that were talking about all these different, you know, you into these bands, and like every single band on there I knew was like weird shit.
Well, give me some examples of weird shit.
Gong, Henry Cow, Art Bears, like all these like, you know, strange.
Perhaps stuff that we couldn't find on Spotify.
Brian Eno.
Oh,
that's
Brian
about
Eno.
That's as close as you're gonna get to anything mainstream. But it, you know, I mean, at that point in time, your musical taste really kind of defined you more as an individual, and defined anyone who was into this kind of stuff and was out about it. I mean, it was kind of like, oh wow, we have to find these people. So we went to this loft, and it turns out the loft was owned by a man named Giorgio Gomelski, who was the former manager of, he managed the Beatles for an evening, he managed the Rolling Stones for a week, but he managed the Yardbirds for a long time. And what happened as a result of that was that he kept selling their catalog every year to a different record company. So at one point, if you went into like a record store, you went to the Yardbird section, it would be the biggest section in the store because he kept re-releasing these records, and that's how he paid his rent. But he kind of created a salon for people like us to get together, and that's where we met Bill, because he was the guy who made the flyers.
So is that when material started?
We became Zoo, Z-U, then that's what Giorgio kind of named us, because he wanted to have it. He fancied himself to be like Serge Diaghilev or something like that, like this Russian impresario, you know.
So New York Times said material, quote, for a rock group with a particular solid sounding name, material is curiously elusive. Sometimes it is an increasingly influential band. It's been singled out as one of New York's most original new groups by critics in the country abroad. Did you expect to get so much accolades from the early on from the New York Times?
At that point in time, we weren't expecting anything.
Right.
Nah, it was, a lot of that came as a shock. But you know, you have to remember, like, New York at that point in time was one of the most amazing places to be creatively, I think, at any point in the last probably like 100 years. It was incredible. It was just going through such an incredible transformation. It was scary. It was like, it was basically like Disneyland on acid for, like, you know, for people who are like anywhere like out above the age of like 15. It was incredible. And you know, I mean, there were places that were scary. Like, you didn't know, you didn't know if you went down certain blocks if you were actually going to come out the other end alive. You know, mm-hmm. And you could, you know, you could live in New York. I had friends who lived in like lofts. These people lived on like 2nd between 13th and 14th. Like the entire block, one loft, it was basically a complete railroad all the way through.
Where the High Line is now.
It was, no, it's on the east side.
Oh, okay.
It's on the east side. It was an entire city block long. They paid $200 a month because it was artist space.
Wow.
You know, this is real estate. Like something like that now would have probably cost about $50 million.
Sure.
Right. It was incredible. You could find stuff like that. No one wanted to live there. It was just junkies, artists, and, you know, people who were just scraping to get by. But, like, you could have the most incredible musical collaborations. And it was fertile ground. Everything went. Nothing was sacred. You know, no one said no to anything. It was just, it was incredible.
Well, let's talk about your collaborations with that. When you segue into that, you talk about that. You collaborate with material with a lot of different people,
particularly
like Nona Hendrix.
Yep.
Tell me about your work with Nona.
She sang on a record that we worked on. She sang on a couple of records, actually. This one single that became kind of like a big in sort of like in the disco clubs and like the...
Was this when she was with LaBelle? Or
no, this is all post-LaBelle, and we wound up producing two records with her. And this was like after she'd worked with Talking Heads. On Remain in Light. That was very exciting. You know, we worked with her, and, you know, when we produced her record, we were working with guys like David Byrne and with Bernie Worrell, who was another one of the funniest people I've ever met.
Right. Bernie was amazing.
Oh my God. Absolutely amazing.
Is that what led you to work with Brian Eno?
I think what led us to work with Brian Eno was that Bill... he was really good at being able to, at networking.
Mm-hmm.
So what he would do is he would like stand outside, every morning he would get up real early and stand outside Eno's apartment on 8th Street, and he'd just wait for Eno to come out. He'd stand there for hours and wait for him to come out, and he'd be like, hey man, you got something for me? He kept trying to get work. And Bill was lucky because he was such an amazing bassist. That, you know, and he had, his name was around, so people knew who he was.
Right.
It was the kind of thing where he wasn't just some, like, you know, jack off like on the street. He was like, no, he was serious. And after a while, you know, asked him if he would play in this record called My Life in the Bush of Ghosts, which was that was a pretty important record, and that led to us all working together. I mean, it really started with Eno and this guy Bob Quine and Bill and one or two other people, and I felt really bad because I wasn't involved. And then they moved to our studio in Brooklyn. One day, Eno came to me and said, would you like to join us? And I was like, would I?
Twist my arm.
Yeah.
Is that what led to, also, you know, you did this, and then you have this Herbie Hancock, Rockit, comes along, and he found that song through a demo tape? That's what I have here.
Could you elaborate on that?
Yeah, so...
Found some of the demo tape.
Yeah, Mr. Hancock decided to work with you guys on the basis of a demo tape, a prototype of Rockit, complete with scratching by DST.
You'll have to send me the source for that.
Sure, I will. I think it was Rolling Stone.
Oh, well, let me correct Mr. Stone. No, that's not how it happened, actually.
So it's folklore.
That is, yeah, I mean, there are other words for it, too.
Right.
But no, what really happened was that Herbie was kind of like at the end of his run with Sony.
Yeah.
And he had a guy working for him who had been trying to get us together for a long time. Really, Bill and our drummer, Fred. I wasn't really so much in the mix because Herbie's a keyboardist. People thought of me as a keyboardist, and it was like, why do you need two of them besides Herbie's Herbie? Who's this guy?
Right. Yeah.
So, he's at the end of his run with Sony, and no one took him seriously at this point. Like, he'd sort of shot his wad, more or less, and they were going to give him a very small amount of money, $100,000, which of course these days I'm sure people would love to have.
Sure.
To make any record at all. Though back then that was a pittance. And that was sort of like a, you know, fare thee well, nice knowing you type deal. And I think at that point, this guy convinced Herbie, what do you have to lose, you know, for working with these guys? And he kind of, this guy, Tony Milan, who's his personal assistant, says, okay, he wants two songs. Let's see where it goes. You know, they were planning on having more producers on the record. And so we kind of sat there with it. It was like, and we were thinking, what would Herbie be doing? What kind of music would Herbie be making if he kind of stayed the course of being a sort of like jazz rock innovator who'd done so many amazing records, who worked with Miles Davis, you know, who'd done Chameleon, who'd done Watermelon Man, which are like, they're groundbreaking records, right? You know, who basically advanced the use of ARP synthesizers in music, you know, mm-hmm. and really brought that kind of technology to the forefront. What would he be doing if he stayed on that course and hadn't made all these pop records for Sony in the interim? And all of a sudden, this innovative great comes head to head with this nascent form of music, hip hop, you know, that really wasn't mainstream at all, but seemed to us to be the answer to a lot of the stagnation that was going on in music at that time. You know, so what's going to happen then? And we began to sort of imagine and conceptualize what that would be like, and that's basically where the track came from. I'll built the bed up that way.
Stop you right here, and we'll play a little bit of that. Is it working? Was there a generation gap? Did you feel there was a generation gap?
No, not especially.
Okay, great. Wonderful.
I mean, there was sort of an odd sort of disparity between us.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't chalk it up to any of those things.
Sure.
It was just sort of like a, you know, that.
Right.
Sort of who you kind of thing.
Did you, I heard that you had to help him understand the usage of turntables?
I don't know if I'd put it that way. I just don't think that the concept had really, that he'd come across the concept that much prior. Because he was really looking more at the upper echelons of pop music and R&B, because I think that's where he really wanted to be. That's where he saw himself being. And it just wasn't in the cards. But I don't think the idea of him using a turntable as an instrument, I don't think that idea really had registered with him up to that point. So when he heard it for the first time, and he'd listened to other hip-hop records before that, But I don't think that it registered. When he heard that on what was going to be his record, he was kind of like, what? What is that?
When the song came out, from what I've been told, the song came out and it was kind of universally panned by the critics. Rolling Stone gave it 2 stars.
I think they gave it 2.5.
Oh, okay, 2.5.
Come on,
2.5.
2.5.
Okay, yeah, I'm sorry, Herbie, wherever you are, I don't want to
short
here.
That,
yeah.
That hurts.
But, sorry, you need a hug.
Later. We can settle our debts.
And he turned this track into the label, and the label said, what the hell is this, essentially, is that right?
I missed that part of it.
Yeah.
I missed that part of it. I do know that Herbie didn't really know what to make of it, even after we finished the first two. I do know that after that, we were retained to do the entire record. So
sure.
Dylan and I both figured, well, I guess we must have done something right here because Herbie wants to finish up with us instead of having more people produce.
Well, his instincts are right because the 1984 Grammys, he performs it. And it changed his life. He says it was the greatest night of his life playing that, and he won a Grammy for that.
Yeah.
For our best R&B instrumental performance.
Yes, he did.
That's great. So, after Herbie, what happens? What do you do?
I got booted from material.
Okay.
And I became a working stiff, pounding the pavement, trying to find more production work because I felt that's where my life was going to go, and realizing that that the rest of the world kind of associated this song more with Laswell than with me, so I was kind of in a position where, like, wow, I'm going to have to do something to kind of either dispel that or work through that somehow, and I just kept having these meetings with A&R people who saw me as some kind of, you know, basically a kid off the street, so they're kind of like, ah, get out of here, you know? And one day I went to EMI Records, and I think the A&R there, a guy named Michael Barrickman, must have taken pity on me or something. He said, we actually have an artist that might work with you. And it turned out that was the Red Hot Chili Peppers.
And that record was the Uplift Mofo Party Plan.
That's right.
Did you record this project by traveling in a van with them?
No. I actually went, the first time that I met with them,
uh-huh.
I went to meet them in New Orleans. They were playing at Tipitina's. It was the first time I met with them or saw them. And the first thing I saw when I came in the place was this guy jumping around on stage wearing, you know, in his underwear playing the bass like he was trying to destroy it with his bare hands. And I was like, what is going on in this place? It was incredible. Like, you know, to me, like, I was listening to it, hearing all the things that were musically, like, not happening in this music, but at the same time, I was like, this is like, there was just this fierce energy. And this is happening at the time when all these hair metal bands are big, and you've got these guys being maniacs, in spite of all that, being the rugged individualists that they were. And you just had to admire that. It was really amazing. And, you know, I traveled with them in the van from New Orleans to Dallas, Texas, which is where they were playing their next gig. And that's where the van came in.
And this is when you found out that they had more than just musical, you know, they were more than musical beasts, but they had a lot of personal issues, drugs, stuff like that.
I had a hint of it.
Yeah, you had a hint of it, right?
Yeah.
When you worked that record, you kind of follow up with Mother's Milk.
Yeah.
Is that the next one?
Yeah.
And that was more personal issues.
It was different because Anthony at that point had become clean.
Mm-hmm.
And
you find out that John Frusciante is a great songwriter.
Well, he had just joined the band. And I don't think anyone realized what he was capable of. Mm-hmm. He brought in a song and I was like, oh my goodness. This person has actually written the very first song that the Chili Peppers have ever had. You know, I mean, because a lot of their songs, like anything that you could call a song before that, I wouldn't say it's a song. It was a song per se, but this guy actually had an understanding of composition. You know, there were real melodies that you could discern. It wasn't like chant or like, you know, gang vocals singing like simple melodic phrases and stuff like that. And he really did understand a lot of aspects of music that the other guys hadn't. And he really was their secret weapon in a lot of ways. I mean, my feeling about the Chili Peppers was always that the success of the band kind of hinges on who the guitarist is, because the guitarist is always the composer in their case. And John was he's an excellent, excellent composer.
Whose idea was it to cover Higher Ground?
Well, we were debating what cover song to do, and we were down to two. It was either that or If You Want Me to Stay by Sly. And yeah, that's no. I mean, that's not a song that you want to touch.
Sure.
You know, If You Want Me to Stay is like, A, it's a brilliant song, but B, it's essentially, I'd say it's about 95 to 99% all about the vocal performance. And no one's going to touch Sly.
Right.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, sure.
No one.
They did do it on 3D Silent.
Yeah, it's a shame, isn't it?
let's listen to a little bit of Higher Ground. Obviously, that bass line, that Flea bass line, is iconic.
Yeah.
Did you know that, or did you kind of expect that Flea was gonna be Flea, as opposed to, you know, I think he's probably one of the most recognizable people in it, or at least the most name dropped into the Hot Chili Peppers.
You mean on this song or in general?
Or in general, yeah.
Well, he was always pretty much that guy. You know, you can't. I never really saw him try to be anyone else. So,
So you go from Red Hot Chili Peppers to something which I'm sure this record plowed the road for you. For I would imagine for a lot of other production gigs, but you move from that to almost the polar opposite with the Violent Femmes.
I guess so.
What about the Violent Femmes made you want to work with them?
That they were interesting, that they were different and kind of bizarre, and that I thought that there's a certain like endearing sort of quirkiness to them, mm-hmm. that you know, and also there's definitely some angst in there, and to me that kind of thread is something that I could relate to, because there's a degree of that in a lot of the other stuff that I was working on. I mean, that's somewhat of an underlying theme, you know, or some kind of drama in the music. And yeah,
that record, really, the previous records didn't necessarily live up to expectations, but then you brought them back with American Music, which was a moderate hit at Modern Rock Radio.
Was it?
It was.
Okay.
We'll play this.
Okay.
Can I put in something like, this is American Music, take one. 1, 2, 3, 4. Do you like American music? I like American music. Don't you like American music? Hey.
talk in the beginning of that. What went through your head during that time? When you just heard that?
This is agony. Help. It was a tough record to me.
It was a tough record.
Yeah, it was.
Definitely. Was it because of personalities? Or
yeah, I think so. I think so. It was very. There was definitely a bit of acrimony going on. We got through it, but it was,
sure. The other thing about what I see a lot in your discography is that you have artists who do covers a lot. You know, Do You Really Want to Hurt Me was a cover on that record.
That's right.
Do you feel any responsibility for the song when an artist is covering something that is really great, like Higher Ground, or Do You Really Want to Hurt Me?
Responsibility in what sense?
Well, like, you know, serving the song as opposed to egos or, you know, crazy guitar solos or any of that
stuff. I think if you're gonna do a cover version of someone else's song, you better really apply some of your own personality to it. It should be something that you're able to kind of like to pull into your own orbit and apply your own signature to. Like people who do sort of like replica versions of songs, not a good idea. I mean, I found that like a lot of versions of Hendrix songs, you know, that's just areas that you should stay away from. Although it's funny because we did that with the Chili Peppers as well, and I actually think they pulled Fire off pretty well. But like for the most part, like cover songs, that's very very delicate, you know, ice to skate on. Unless you've got a piece of music that weds so nicely to the artist that you go like, okay, this is fantastic. You know, but yeah, you definitely don't want to get into like too far into anything that where an individual kind of says, okay, this is my part to do this, do the guitar solo.
We move on to 1992, turbulent year. And you do a record, Grave Dancers Union, by Soul Asylum.
Yeah.
And I found out that you recorded this in the midst of the LA riots.
Part of it, yeah.
Yeah. What was that like as far as, you know, what were your emotions during that recording? Were your emotions high? Were you distracted at all by any of from the riots when you're recording?
No. The riots had actually happened a week before we showed up in Los Angeles. We came here to record Booker T, to do all the Hammond B3.
Booker T. Jones.
Booker T. Jones, yeah. To do all the the organ overdubs. And we were so exhausted at that point because we'd been working a graveyard shift in New York. So we didn't know which end was up. But I remember we were driving through and we were going up La Brea and all of a sudden, there are all these like burnt out like gas stations and convenience stores. I'm like, oh my God, what the? This is like a war zone. It was really deep, you know, to see the leftovers, the detritus of what had happened as a result of that. And I think without actually being conscious of it, it really sort of colored what happened on that session. Like it added sort of an extra layer of drama that we weren't even thinking about. I think it made what Booker did so much more compelling.
Tell us what, you know, Booker's a revelation, and he's amazing. What did you witness with Booker in that session?
God, the guy came in and did like seven songs in like 5 hours, or five songs in 7 hours, excuse me. And I have never seen anyone handle a B3 like that before in my life. It was amazing. I think I was telling you earlier, like, he would sit down at the thing, like, he'd basically do a couple, he'd do like one pass to get like the chart, to like figure out what the chords were and what he was gonna play. And he'd knock it out in about like three or four passes. And I was just looking at him going like, this is just a guy who's playing a fucking B3. How is it sounding so good? I mean, B3 sounds good anyway. It's just a great sounding instrument if you drop it in the right place. But he sounds better. How's that working? Harmonically, it just sat with everything. And I don't know. I mean, you can't say I've got a specific kind of touch because a B3 isn't really, it isn't really touch-based the way a piano is. It doesn't have dynamics in the same way. Like, so how's this working? Like, it's not his drawbar settings. Like, there's some kind of magic going on. But the minute he sits down in front of the instrument, it's like, that's Booker T, and this sounds really fucking good, you know? And he'd do a couple of passes, and we'd just look at each other and go like, yeah. I don't know what you're going to say about that.
What do you
that.
Tell Booker T, you know?
Well, you know, like, yeah. Well, I mean, there was like once or twice where I was like, could you do this, could you do that? And you'd sort of be like, all right.
So that record, you know, spawned a hit, Runaway Train. That the chorus doesn't start until 1 minute into the song.
Yeah, kind of drags on a bit,
sure.
Doesn't it?
Yeah, but it was still a hit. It goes against, you know, don't bore us, get to the chorus.
Somewhat, yeah.
Sure. So after that becomes one of your masterpieces, Super Unknown, Soundgarden. How did they come about?
A guy I was working with was saying, you should really try and do this record. I was like, okay. And then he said, well, it looks like they've picked a producer, but, you know, you might want to try anyhow, because I don't think it's engraved in stone. And it turned out it was going to be Rick Rubin who was going to produce that. So
you ate Rick Rubin's lunch.
It could be said, yes. I wouldn't put it that way. So I went up to Seattle and I met with them. They were obviously open to the meeting, so I guess they hadn't really made their minds up yet. And I wouldn't necessarily say that we hit it off, but I think that they were receptive to the process. So they decided that we would work together on the condition that I cut a song, like two songs with them prior to us actually making this record. So we went in for about a week, cut two songs, they liked it, and that was the beginning.
How did Frank Sinatra, there's a role Frank Sinatra played on this record.
Yeah, well, I think at a certain point I just became aware that Chris's vocal performances were there was always like a sense that I got from Chris that he wasn't really present. I mean, I guess that's a weird thing to hear someone say about someone who's that, like, that visceral and that raw. But I always felt like there was some kind of, like, undertone of, like, I don't want you to really see what's inside. The only place that I didn't really hear it so much was on that Temple of the Dog record. I was like, I'm going to make sure that on this record that we get to see, like, a glimpse of that he does, like, that he makes a really strong emotional statement. So, you know, one of the ways that I thought would work was, like, I wanted him to focus on phrasing. And I found, and I still do find, that a lot of vocalists, when they perform, they tend to do things in really kind of like blocks. You know what I mean? It's like da 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 da, da 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 da, da 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 da. You know, instead of the way the style of like an older singer, where like the vocal kind of sits on top of the music. It's like another instrument, but it's a lead instrument that's constantly there, and it's kind of like taking its time playing with the phrase and like pulling it back, pushing it forward, like really messing with the performance, so that you're kind of drawn into it instead of these kind of like blocks where it seems like the vocal almost like sits right on top of everything and is right in time with everything metrically, boom, 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 boom. How interesting is that, right? So, you know, like when I thought of Chris, I was like, if he loosens up and he just gives a little bit more and kind of takes advantage of the space between the notes and stuff like that, I just feel it would be so much more compelling. So I played him some Frank Sinatra songs. I played him Only the Lonely, which is one of, to me, like the sad stuff that he did, like the really depressed stuff, and the stuff that he did with Antonio Carlos Jobim, that's his best. Because you really see a side of him that you're not getting in all the kind of like up-tempo, kind of like, you know, cool swinging type shit. And these songs, they're some of them are really dark, like Only the Lonely is like, it's about as melancholy as it gets. But what he does with some of the phrasing is ridiculous, because he listened, he modeled a lot of his phrasing, I'm sure a lot of you guys know this, around trombone, because he was in a band with Tommy Dorsey.
And trombone for singers, I just learned this today, that a lot of singers like the trombone because the trombone can pitch. Like,
yeah.
Matches the pitch.
Yeah. The slides, when you listen to some of his phrasing and you hear him go, like that,
yeah.
It's exactly replicating a trombone slide. You know, and some of the way he's breathing, like at the end of the bridge on that song, when he goes, he does these breaths, a hopeless little dream like that comes true if you and he holds that note so long, like modern singers don't do stuff like this, and it's not, they don't necessarily need to do it, but having the understanding of how the voice can actually direct a song is amazing, and people don't take advantage of this at all. And I wanted to show this to Chris, to give him the opportunity to kind of really own the song so that it became his, instead of him just being another instrument.
Did he look at you funny when you started playing Frank Sinatra?
Fuck yes, he did. He laughed at me. When I was done, he was like, okay, like that. But it was interesting because something really registered. And you,
when you were doing vocals with him, you kind of left him a lot to his own devices, did you not?
Yeah, I had to, because I realized in a very short amount of time that there was something about Chris. And this is one of the things that I really try and do with performers, is to sort of like get inside their psyches and kind of get a feel for what they're thinking, what they're feeling, you know? And if someone's uncomfortable in a studio and they have to do their job, like, I have to know why. I have to know why so I can fix it. So I can help them kind of tool the situation so they're able to kind of maximize what it is that they're doing. And I realized that he couldn't bear the idea, the feeling of being in a room by himself with this wonderful microphone in front of him and have people on the other side, all by himself, have people on the other side of a glass not knowing what they're saying. And it didn't even matter if you put the listen mic on, you know, so like he's part of the conversation. It was more of a sense of that there are other people there. I can relate to this because I don't like other people around when I'm trying to focus on something. So I was like, this guy makes really good demos at home. He knows this process. All he has to do is be in the control room by himself with the equipment, you know, so we brought him in. We gave him a U87.
Let's talk about that microphone. He destroyed the diaphragms of five microphones.
Yeah, five. And he went through five of them. Because he sang so loud that he could take, and those diaphragms are not very resilient to begin with. Like, you can blow them fairly easily, but for a person to do it with his voice, that takes a lot of effort. He destroyed, I saw bills for these things, like we had to, We had to pay for new diaphragms every time. Every time he
$20,000. Well, upwards.
No, it's an 87, so
okay.
A couple hundred bucks maybe. But it's the principle.
Sure. Right.
Yeah.
When did you know that this record was special?
The very minute I heard the demo for Black Hole Sun.
Let's hear that.
Release our feminine side.
Okay.
it's the construction of it's really, really emotionally powerful because the music is so well constructed. Every last bit of that music, of those songs, it's just so well done. The use of the voices, the use of the textures, the actual parts. The music's orchestrated like concert music. It's gorgeous from top to bottom.
What was Zach telling you what were those conversations like when you're in the midst of listening to ABBA?
Well, I think it was usually at the end of the night, probably around 2 or 3 in the morning, after we'd got done recording a whole bunch of like loud guitar parts for an Ozzy Osbourne record, and we'd just sit there. He would have there'd be a massive quantity of empty beer cans in a wastebasket right about there next to him, overflowing every day. And we'd just be sitting there like that, and he'd turn to me and be like, Mike, this shit is fucking amazing.
The image is I'm never going to be able to get that out of my head.
Man, it was, but it's like sitting there with your best friend listening to music, just going like, oh God, I know it's so good,
Another person that played that record, Rick Wakeman of Yes.
Yeah.
What was your experience like with Rick?
He is one of the funniest human beings I've ever met in my entire life. He had us pissing laughing all the time. And he's an obviously amazing keyboard player. But I was telling you about the story with the Mellotron.
Yeah.
How I'd always wanted to have a Mellotron, actually. And I bought one like a few weeks before, and I was like, oh wow, Rick Wakeman's going to be playing on our record. I'm going to show him my Mellotron. He'll play it. Wow! I was so excited. He walks into the room the day of the session, and he sees the thing, and he kind of goes like, like, you don't want me to play that, do you? And it turned out that he was one of the many keyboard players who were scarred by Mellotrons, who were just terrified of them and didn't want to have anything to do with them again. I had to beg him, please, just do it for me, and he acquiesced, he played.
Did you have to deal with Sharon when you were working with us?
I did.
Did you hair get more gray when you had to deal with that?
All I can say about Sharon is that if you're on her good side and you're working together as a team, I don't think that you could find a better person to work with. I don't have any experience of being on her bad side, but I've spoken to quite a few people who have, and their hair is great.
All right, so fast forward to you do Ozzy, you do a Social Distortion record, and then you do a little record called Celebrity Skin with Courtney Love and Hall.
Yeah.
How did you meet Courtney?
I'd actually met her some years before, though I don't think that she actually remembered. She was not quite compos mentis at that particular point in time. But I got asked, you know, I actually got referred to the project by Billy Corgan, who had been asked to produce, and he said he couldn't because he was going to be working on a new Smashing Pumpkins record. And so he suggested me, to which and he also recommended me for Manson's record as well, to which I can only owe him undying thanks. So that's how Courtney and I first met.
You said that 70% of what you hear in the record is from the first two takes of the guide vocal.
At least 70%. We'd spent a long time recording vocals after, because, you know, guide vocals, you're going to do everything like, you know, maybe a day, maybe even less. But that included like all her doubles as well. Like, we just did everything, day and a half. And I realized that as we spent all this time doing her vocals, that I was just missing this essence that I'd heard before and I couldn't quite place when. And I started to realize that it was when we hit guides and I went back to him, and sure enough, it was all there. And I was like, that's our record. She doesn't need to do any more singing.
Let's listen.
Oh, make me over. I'm all I wanna be. A walking study. In demonology. Hey, so bad you can make it. Yeah, now you're willing to make it. Hey, so bad you can make it.
Great song.
Yeah, it is.
That's here.
Those are tuned, by the way.
Oh, they are.
You wouldn't know it to hear it, but yeah.
That year, 98, was a big year for you.
Yeah.
You do that, and then did you transition right into Mechanical Animals?
Yeah.
And, you know, what did you, when you first met Marilyn Manson, what were your thoughts?
He dressed really nicely for me today.
That's pretty funny. Wow. That's honest. You know, I've had these conversations with you before when we had dinner a couple of months ago, that he's a very strong personality.
Yeah.
How do you navigate strong personalities within the studio?
I think it really depends on what kind of strong personality you found yourself in the room with. You know, everyone's, first of all, you have to consider that everyone's different, which means that everyone's neuroses are different as well, and you have to kind of if you really want to work with someone creatively, you have to consider how those things play out and how they could potentially affect the creative process going forward. You know, so how do I navigate around all this stuff? Or how do I incorporate some of it into the process where it's useful? You know, or how do I have to shut this person down and let them and kind of give them the impression that they actually need to, I don't want to use the word sublimate themselves, but, you know, allow themselves to be directed, you know? And you have to prove yourself, essentially, in that situation.
What happens when you're working with an artist who has a strong personality and you have a creative difference and you have an impasse? How do you solve that?
I can give you an example. funnily enough, it was on Courtney's record. It was on Celebrity Skin. Billy Corgan had come in to play bass on one of the songs that, on just one song that Melissa couldn't really quite hack. And he'd written the bass part with a second interval in the bass. And I'd heard this in the demo and I was like, wow, that rub is really unpleasant, you know, because a second in the bass is a lot different than a second in guitar. You know, the lower the rub is, like there's beats, it's just real ugly. And it really calls a lot of attention away from the melody to that rub, which is not something, you know, that you want a bass guitar to do. So I was like, okay, we're gonna move this to the guitar. It works well, the second is nice, but we don't need to have it in the bass where it's really poking out. So he started playing his bass line the way he wrote it, and I was like, you know, we actually changed that part. You know, we stayed on the root, we took the second out, and he's like, yeah, but that's how I wrote the part. And, you know, I was like, I understand that, but we, you know, that rub is actually affecting the way the vocal is being perceived and everything else. He's like, yeah, well, that's the way I wrote it, and that's how I'm playing it. And I was like, I get that. So this went on for like about a minute or so, and I realized that with that line, with, you know, that direction, we weren't going to get anywhere. And I said, look, would you consider this? How about we play it, you play it for about a minute, play the part the way you wrote it, and then try it without the second. Just let's do that. If at the end you decide that the second is working better than without, we'll do it the way you wrote it. I'm not going to say anything more. And that'll be the end of it. He said, okay. So, you know, after a minute, he was like, we'll do it without the second. You know, but the thing is that that wasn't a situation where someone's being manipulated. It's kind of like, you use your critical thought to judge what's best for the song in that moment. I'm not gonna stand in your way. I'm gonna let, you know, the chips fall where they need to fall. You know, but you have to consider how you want this song to be heard in its best light.
Going back to Mechanical Animals, how long did it take to make that record?
From Soup to Nuts, probably about 3 months, in the studio 2.5 months. Pretty quick. I was like, great, but you know, I'm up against Lauryn Hill and like a bunch of other people, so like, yeah, I get a nice plaque off it anyway.
So fast forward to 2002, and you work with Korn. That was a very long process, was it not?
About 15 months.
15 months. Mm-hmm. How long did it take for you just to do pre-production on that record?
That was about 7 months. Pre-production, 7 months.
Just in pre-pro.
Mm-hmm.
Why did it take so long?
There's a lot of reasons why it took so long. The first one was that when I started working with them, they sent me a CD that had 40 tracks on it. And two of those tracks actually had somewhat finished ideas with no singing. The rest of it were just like riffs and jams. And I was like, this is not a record. This is not going to be a record either. we are starting from like ground zero with this. And
you're right here.
They basically had to start writing from the get-go, but the environs that they had to work in were absolutely abysmal. It was a terrible, terrible place.
In Long Beach.
It was in Long Beach.
My hometown.
Is it?
Yes.
Well, oh, that's right, yeah. It was actually, I think it was a car dealership or something like that, because it had like a mezzanine level. It's like 20,000 square feet. It was ridiculous. And the best part was that they had like their kind of like stage set up with like a PA and everything, and they would start playing together, and all of a sudden you'd realize that you couldn't hear anything anymore and that you'd wet yourself, and that like everything that was metal was starting to kind of like break on you.
So you leave, you kind of force them to leave Long Beach. Where did you go?
We went to Arizona.
Yes, and that posed some problems as well, did it not?
It was fraught with danger from beginning to end. There's no question.
What kind of danger was it fraught with?
Well, you know, not to get too far into it, but the twin hydra of sex and drugs, I think, was the issue.
Quote: I didn't realize how many strip joints there were for pure insanity in Phoenix.
Who said that?
You.
Oh. It was a revelation, it really was. I thought this was a family town. You know? I mean, it is it's a red state, for God's sake.
Jonathan Davis said that when they met you, he said that your vision was to make an amazing sounding rock record that can never be made again.
That wasn't exactly my vision. I would say that that's pretty much how I would like to approach anything that I ever work on. I think it was more they sort of tasked me. At one point, one of the guys said, "We want to make our dark side of the moon." And I looked at him and I was like, "Do you realize what you're asking? Do you realize the kind of pact you've made with the devil just now? If that's what you really want to do." And I don't think that they did realize it at the time, but 15 months later, I think they had an inkling.
You spent a whole month getting drum sounds. 50 mics just on the drum set?
Nah.
That you picked out and tested, according to Jonathan?
Yeah, a month? Nah. It was a week and a half.
More folklore.
This is Paul Bunyan type shit. The only glitch, I think, in getting drum sounds was the fact that we got our drum sounds around the tech, which back then I sort of preferred to do so the drummer didn't have to work so hard. And the tech, unfortunately, could hit better than David could. Like David didn't know how to strike properly, so he choked anytime he hit a drum. Excuse me, so once he sat down at the drum kit, we had this amazing drum set and it all fell apart and we were like, oh God, no. So we had to start all over again. But that was like, I think it had gotten us we'd gotten that sound like 5 days. So it was like another 4 days to get something that really kind of tailored itself to David. And it wasn't quite 50 mics, but it was close,
Another quote from Jonathan said, "Sometimes I'd walk in and sing and you just say, go home, your voice ain't right."
Yep.
Yeah. What wasn't right about it?
It's really hard to pin down what that is, but to me, use of intuition, as well as combining that with what's coming over the speakers, that sort of indicates to me what I need to be following. And you know, when the singer comes in and you just are feeling like he's not there, that he's someplace else, that he's distracted, but you can also hear that there are like high partials in his voice that are gone. You know, why did that happen? You know, so I have to think to myself, okay, this guy's like overtired or something like that. And I know what's going to happen if a vocalist is tired like that. He's distracted and his voice isn't in the right place.
So he's not present.
He's not present, and that means that he probably has, I don't know, 3 to 7 good takes in him before his voice starts to fall apart. And then once his voice hits a certain place and he keeps going, he's going to get to a place where he actually starts thrashing it. When he gets to that point, you're looking at a vocalist being out for days. So I have to make that call at that point.
Let's listen.
That there was really good songwriting there.
Mm-hmm. You were under the impression.
You like how I put that, don't you?
I'm not gonna let that go.
I felt let down on that record because I thought that there was going to be more focus on trying to do something more raw, and it sort of deviated into something else. The guitarist in the band, I think, they were sort of co-producers. So the guitarist obviously took advantage of that. And it really became a co-production in every sense of the word, to the extent where I kind of had to take a back seat at times to how the record was being done. And he took a couple of the songs and changed the structures of them. And I felt that he lost things that were essentially strong about them. And I also think that the way he directed the vocalist to sing, because I think it became his ball game after a while. One of the things that the vocalist had was he'd hit notes that were kind of outside of his range, and his voice would break, and it would have this really like nasty kind of edge to it, which is a great kind of disparity against the pop song. But for some reason, the band weren't very keen on that. And I thought that was one of the very things that kind of made their music compelling. So we didn't really get a whole lot of that. You know, so I was actually kind of disappointed by the outcome.
When you approach a record and the songs aren't necessarily there, do you participate in the songwriting process? Or do you just say, take a back seat and say, go and write more or fix that song? How do you approach that when you're working with songwriters?
I don't really like to get into the songwriting process with an artist unless I absolutely have to. And the main reason for that is that I like it to be their vision as unvarnished and as untinkered with as it possibly can be. I like it to be direct and to feel like it actually came from the artist. I feel like my voice is always going to kind of alter that a little bit, so I'd rather be dealing with someone else's work always. And also, the thing is if it's my input, all of a sudden I have a subjective perspective on it now. Like it's more precious to me in a way. So my attitude towards it is going to change somewhat. I really don't want that to be in the mix if I can avoid.
All right, so. After that, you did a new record. Yeah. Black Label Society, back with Zach. Pete Yorn, The Bronx. Matt says hi, by the way.
Hi.
Love Drug, Militia Group, all the new label record.
Mm-hmm.
And then you go and you're back with Courtney again.
Mm-hmm.
What was the difference? Was there a difference between the first time you worked with Cole and the second time?
Yeah, there were many differences. I definitely felt that I didn't get a Courtney that was as on point as the Courtney that I got when we did Celebrity Skin. And she wasn't as focused either. Like, she really wasn't, I didn't feel as much of a sense of commitment to what we were doing. And she left a lot of the artistic decisions in the laps of other people. And
you worked with it was a whole new band at that point.
It was a whole new band, right? And the thing is that whether I liked him or not, she had a very good creative rapport with Eric Erlandson. Like, he was a very good person for her to work with. I mean, they detested each other and they got into fights a lot, but the creative relationship worked. And I am not a big fan of Melissa's either, but her voice worked really well. And I thought she was a very good bassist.
Quote, producers love to have a big ego saying, I got them to do this or that. But actually, you can't make anybody do something they don't want to do. It's more about convincing them why working in a certain way will yield better results.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So we're running out of time, and in homage to James Lipton, I'm going to give you a little questionnaire. What is your favorite word?
What?
Just go with me.
Okay.
Go with me. Yeah.
Oh God, there's so many of them.
Jeez. You guys, like, I love words so much, and then you're making me draw a blank here. This isn't fair.
This is exactly why I'm doing this.
Oh my God, this is terrible. Feisty, I don't know.
Okay. What's your least favorite word?
Jubilee. That's one of them.
What turns you on creatively?
Leather.
Me too.
I guess we've got something else in common. People who really want to take chances, who want to take risks, who want to go further, who aren't comfortable in a safe space, and who don't believe in plateaus.
What turns you off?
People who like working by rote, who like formulas, who use templates and who absolutely refuse to do anything creatively and follow directions and conform and will.
What's your favorite curse word? Say it. Come on. Do you want to hear him say it?
Wait, one word?
You can do multiple. That's fine.
There's so many. Well, there's a Yiddish saying. I need you toiten bankus, which means I need you like a corpse full of suction cups. I'm not going to even get into it.
All right. I won't explore that.
Okay.
Right,
yeah.
What sound or noise do you love?
There's so many. I mean, where do you start? Like, I guess I like listening to my son fart. It's a good one. They're unbelievable, actually. They're very robust. They're 7-month-old. Seriously, they're good.
What sound or noise do you hate?
Well, it's gotta be fingers on a chalkboard or something like that. No, worse. Worse is subwoofer from a movie or a disco record from an apartment or a hotel suite or something like that next to wherever I am. Like that.
What profession, other than producing, would you like to attempt?
Criminal pathology, probably.
What profession would you not like to do?
Fecal engineering.
And last but not least, if heaven exists, what would you like to hear God say when you arrive at the pearly gates?
Hi. I don't know. You, something, I don't know. Something like that.
And I think we're going to have to leave it at that.
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, Michael Beinhorn.
Thank you.
And we have time for questions. Just come on up to the microphone. Come on down. Anyone? Bueller?
Yeah, I was wondering on Super Unknown, there's a lot of odd tunings on the guitars.
Yeah.
I was wondering if you had any input on those tunings, or the band already came to you with all that?
They made up their own tunings. I wrote them all down as well, and to this day, I've never ever seen anyone who come up with tunings like that. There was one song actually. I it was My Wave. It was E and everything else is B. That's all it is. It just play it like bar all the way. It's incredible.
Was it that middle finger intentional when you were miming that out?
No.
Okay.
I didn't mean it.
Alright, sure. Calling Dr. Freud. Next, anyone?
Hello.
Hi.
What would you say for songwriters who like are mostly focused on like the lyrics part of the song, as far as like instrumentation and how to, you kind of touched on it a little bit, but how to match the lyrics, which can be like you're really great at, but like having the instruments match.
So I'm trying to piece this together, because you've also, are you including melody in this?
Yeah.
Is that something that you're interested in focusing on, or is it just the orchestration of the instruments around the lyrics themselves?
The lyrics and melody.
The lyrics and melody, okay. Well, I mean, it depends what style of music you're writing in, obviously. I think that's key, but, you know, I think most people would agree that, like, a great song is something that can be accompanied, melody, and lyrics by one instrument. If you have a piece of music that can be compelling and can be played with a piano or an acoustic guitar, that's really all you are gonna need to start with. But again, it depends on the style of music that you're working with. You know what I mean? And also the mood of the music that you're trying to make. Some music is obviously more production-oriented and needs more instrumentation, you know? But by and large, proper songs really need to revolve around only one instrument, and that's it. That can play rhythm and harmonic accompaniment, and also give you some kind of indication of what the bass notes are gonna be. My pleasure.
Thank you, Michael.
My pleasure.
My question is, do you foresee some sort of revival of rock or alternative sound? I mean, like, less production in the box, more back to the live production. I mean, the mainstream. Thank you.
You're welcome. And the answer to that would be a decided yes, I do. Because I've read a lot recently where people are talking about, oh, rock is dead, rock is a dying art form, no one likes rock music anymore, poor rock music, you know, and that's nonsense. Rock dies when it says it's dead, you know what I mean? Like when someone doesn't, the whole world doesn't want to pick up an electric guitar anymore, when people don't want to make music like this, that's when rock is dead. If someone's writing about this, or some moron at a record company says we're not gonna put out rock music anymore, it's ridiculous. There are lots of rock bands all over the world who are earning a nice living making rock music, and this is a time where rock is dead. Give me a break, you know? So yes, there's room for that. There's room for lots of hybrid forms of music as well that use all sorts of instruments, including electric guitars, including live drums and programmed drums. There should be no one should be laying down any kind of laws about what people make, how they make it, or anything like that. So yes, abso-fucking-lutely.
Hi.
Hey.
So I actually had two questions, and I kind of packed them in one. So the first question would be, I was really curious at what you've done ear training wise, and I don't mean ear training like musical like melodies and chords and stuff like that, but more like the technical ear training stuff, like frequencies and that kind of stuff. And other than that, that's part of the second question, I guess. What would you say are, let's say, two or three very like valuable qualities that you would have to bring to be successful in that kind of business?
So when you say ear training, are you talking about recording engineering?
Yeah.
Well, my field of expertise is not in engineering, but I've had to engineer. So that has basically come from being around other people who are technically much stronger than I am and watching them work. Not in a classroom, but in a real world environment. You know, I mean, it's helped because on a lot of those recordings, I'm directing everything. So I have an idea, let's say, and I'm asking the engineer to be able to realize it, and I'm watching how he's doing it, and I'm also listening to what he's doing. So you could say my ear training in that sense is probably the best that it could possibly be, and I'm very fortunate in that sense, and I realize that not everyone else is gonna get that. But, you know, by understanding what recording equipment actually does, then each piece of recording equipment basically has its own personality, and that they all do something a little bit different. And recognizing how that's gonna bring a specific kind of feeling out in an instrument, and how that feeling and that instrument that's being created, that instrument sound is being created, affects the whole piece of music, like all the sounds, how they work together in unity. Do you follow what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But by studying that and being aware of how all these things work individually and as a collective, you know, and how each, you know, let's say how an API mic pre-sounds on the guitar versus a Neve mic pre-sounds on the guitar, you know, and how's it going to sound on this guitar versus that guitar if I'm using that microphone with that cable, with the microphone at this distance away from that speaker cabinet, which happens to be a Marshall. But no, I don't like the Marshall. I want to use a Vox. And I want to move the microphone. You know, like, it's a lot of experimentation and a lot of playing around. Like, I wonder what this does. I wonder what that does. But that's what makes the process so much fun. And it takes you out of, like, the theoretical into the real world where you really start practicing this stuff. And you really get into it. Not just from a standpoint of, like, I learned this shit. But from a standpoint of, I love this shit. Like, oh, my God, this is really exciting. Like, what if? You know, I wonder what this does. You see what I'm saying?
Do you have a favorite engineer that you work with?
I've got a bunch. I mean, I've enjoyed working with Frank Filippetti a lot over the years. He's one of my favorites.
Eric Thorngreen?
I haven't worked with Eric Thorngreen ever. You know, it's funny because there was a while there where I really kind of was, God, I'd love to work with that guy. He's really good.
Next question. Awesome.
Hello.
Hey.
If the Fuel album isn't your favorite album, which one is? I'll update your Wikipedia page.
I don't really have a favorite, to be honest with you. I mean, I've got a lot of favorites. I have to, you know, after what I said about the Fuel album, like, I also want to be clear that I'm grateful for the experience of having done it, because every recording can teach you something. You can never go into recording thinking I know everything there is to know about this, no matter how many times you've done the work. No matter how experienced you are, because there's always going to be something that you've never come up against that you're going to come up against, especially if you're open to it. And the Fuel record was an opportunity for me to really come up against a lot of stuff that I'd never experienced before. I mean, I saw someone on the project who I felt was actually willing to literally shoot himself in the foot just to make a point about how he could control the project. And that's one of the things that makes this kind of record production interesting, watching the psychology, like seeing how people actually do what they do and what motivates them. You know, from that perspective, I'm really grateful for that record, but you know, as far as liking them personally, you know, quite a few of them.
Do you ever stop learning?
No. I need to correct. Yes, you absolutely can, but the decision is always yours. It's always yours. If you decide I've hit, I'm fine at this level, I don't need to go any higher. And I find a lot of people get to that point where they want to just sort of say, I'm comfortable here, I'm really successful, I don't need to learn anymore, I don't need to do anymore. That's it. You've found a comfortable place, and God willing, it's going to take you through the next 5 or 10 years. You know, not forever though. If you are open to the possibility, you will never, ever, ever stop learning, and that's what makes this kind of work better than anything.
Next question.
Hey.
So, this is about your days as material. I imagine you produced your own music.
Yep.
So, how were you able to sort of distance yourself from your own performance?
You know, that's...
The question was, how are you able to distance yourself from the material?
Yeah.
Just tell everybody if you didn't hear
it. Yeah, that's different because... there really wasn't any distance, you know, it's impossible. Everything was completely 100% subjective in the whole thing. You know, we just, each person did what he did, and everyone else was like, okay, fine, you know, and that was that. I am not going to say that that's the best way to make a record. But that was my initial experience. You know, later on, as time went by, we started to kind of critique each other. Like when it got to Rockit, for example, like I actually, when Bill started playing his bass line, I realized that his one was different than where the one actually felt like it should be. You know, I don't remember where the melody, because that melody is actually from it's a vocal melody from a jazz record, and he played it on bass. But his downbeat was totally, it was in a ridiculous place, and it felt like it should go boom, ba-da-da-da-da, because the boom, that downbeat right there, that quarter note, was like, that feels like the start of the line. So I asked him to shift it over to like the start of the bar, and that's really how that happened. But we didn't, we basically didn't critique each other at all. That was a development over time.
Do you have to be an expert in onomatopoeia to be a producer? As far as musician onomatopoeia?
I don't think you have to be an expert, but it doesn't hurt. And you have to be able to, it's nice if you can reel a couple of onomatopoetics out at people, you know, at will, just to kind of like, you know, it's also to decipher their onomatopoeia. Like, what does psh mean?
Yeah.
Obviously there's a psh in it, so it's gotta be a symbol. And maybe there's a bass drum in it as well, because a psh.
Maybe it's a reversing snare.
You never know, right?
Yeah.
Exactly.
Next question.
Hi.
I have a couple of questions, actually.
All right.
The first one is broad, and the second is very specific. The first one is, what is the most important thing for you when it comes to mixing and recording a bass? The second question is, how did your work with Marilyn Manson influence your work with Korn? Because they're very similar bands, the very similar kind of sound in those albums. So how did one influence the other on your part, or were they just completely different works?
Okay. As far as bass guitar recording, I obviously like to have a good amplifier DI blend, and I like to focus on getting the best DI sound possible, but I don't like DIs very much because they're always so clean sounding, so at the end of the day I tend to lean heavily on the amp sound, and I'm usually mixing a whole bunch of bass amps at once, so I tend to split. Usually there's going to be, for me, there's going to be like an Ampeg SVT in the mix, but it... He'll tell you something about bass. That's good. See, seriously, actually, I mean, that's a nice low end. That's actually not a bad reference point, depending on where you're standing, for low end. But I like to have an older SVT in there because of the grit. It's a specific type of grip, but it's also nice to have a Marshall amplified or some kind of guitar amplified bass, just to kind of get a different kind of grip. I like to create a very broad range type of sound with the bass guitar. So it's not, you don't get the sound of any one amplifier, but it's something that's really customized to the musician. As far as Mance's bass sound versus Korn's bass sound, there was one tremendous similarity between both records, and that was, not only was there a very big amp array, but there was an even larger subwoofer array. When we cut drums, one of the things that I do like to do is to have a very, well, I think we had like 6 dual 18 cabinets with a crossover at like 80 or 100 hertz. And like 12,000-15,000 watts of power going into them. So like, basically like ceiling fixtures were coming out of the, you know, things were like crashing on the floor, and the entire studio had to shut down because no other sessions could work. And so I was like, now I wonder what would happen if I took some of those bins and put them in that little closet over there and just tried to compress the room as hard as possible. And that's just what we did. We took two dual 18 bins and actually had them running in the same room with our bass amplification, and it was loud. But what's nice is that when you have subs like that, it tends to bring up harmonics that are outside of the range of where the sub frequencies are. And it amplifies them inside. It amplifies what's coming out of the bass cap, like the actual bass amps. And believe it or not, it actually pushes the fundamental note forward more. So it was kind of like a calculated risk, as you could say. And that was one of the main similarities between those two records. But it helps because you just get much, much more weight, much more low end, and also the low frequencies, which tend to be suppressed more, even if there's a compressor across your 2-mix, it's really hard to suppress those low frequencies. And you can hear them even if you're listening on near-field monitors, like NS10s.
We've got time for 2 more questions. Shannon.
Hey there, Michael.
Hello.
Thank you for coming.
My pleasure.
I was curious what your experience has been like with A&R people over the years and how involved process, and whether that was a good thing or bad.
That's a great question.
That is a really good question, actually. And my answer to that is it really depends on the A&R person. In some cases, they can be really, really helpful. In other cases, they can be absolutely useless. In fact, to the extent where you kind of wonder how someone like that could have ever gotten hired and is actually pulling a paycheck.
Who's some of your favorite A&Rs?
I actually liked working a lot with people at Epic. I liked the former president of Epic, Richard Griffiths. And I mean, a lot of people that I dealt with were like heads of departments, like Polly Anthony was like the head of Epic at 550.
And then Geffen.
Yeah. And she was really good. A lot of the, I actually like John Kaladner as well.
John Kaladner.
He was.
But that was at Geffen as well, was he not?
He was at Geffen. Right. Yeah. He could be a little bit out there at times, but
a little bit.
Yeah. And yeah, he also could. Sometimes he got himself a little bit too far into. He insinuated himself a little bit too far into the creative process when he should have stayed away. So there was a little bit of hubris going on there, but I found that recently a lot of people who do A&R don't really have good listening skills. And they also don't have
listening good, as in listening to music or listening to people?
Well, if you're gonna include that in the mix, I would have to say both.
Yeah.
And they also feel like they've got a lot to prove, which is not a good position to take when you're trying to manage. When you're trying to creatively help someone manage their music and be involved in creative decisions, like you have to really kind of let your ego take a back seat and think, okay, what's going to honor the music that I'm working on? What's going to help make the best product? It's weird. Like, it's like dealing with any other type person. You have to take it on a case-by-case basis, see what their musical acumen is, like if they really know how to listen to what it is that they're listening to, if they can really hear what's there musically, you know, and if they can also understand what needs to be done and also where they need to get involved and where they need to get the hell out of the way, you know, which I think most A&R people will not do. You know, so that's like, that can be a bit of an issue, but it's just something that you have to negotiate around if you're going to have to work though.
One more question.
Hey.
My question is, how do you reconcile objectivity and subjectivity when it comes to trying to finish something? It's like, I have a problem with like really trying to finish stuff because I can always point out something that could be fixed or, you know, improved, but, and I never get anything done because of that, so.
There's a saying, don't let perfect be the enemy of good.
Exactly. Yeah.
Brett Gerwitz told me that.
Well. Yeah, unfortunately, I can't come up with the reverse of that, so I'll have to go with that. My mind was working on that,
sure,
too.
Right.
I think there has to be a stage where you ask yourself if you can be objective first. You know, where you have to be able to honestly assess yourself, go inside and ask yourself the most difficult question. Do I, at this particular moment in time, have the capability to be objective about what I'm working on? And if you answer no, and you have to accept a no if it's real, you know? If you just say yes, yes, yes to everything, you're bullshitting yourself. If you hear no, then you have to take a step back and go, okay, I'm head-fucking myself right now. I'm taking myself straight down a rabbit hole which will lead to nowhere, so what do? And then you figure it out. Does it mean I get away from the music for like a week? Maybe it means I get away from it for a year, depending on if it's not time sensitive or anything like that. But to chase objectivity means that sometimes you have to move away from stuff and really try and separate yourself from it as much as possible. When you start feeling too emotionally connected to things, like, oh, I don't want to change that. I love it so much. It's like, okay, do you love it? Or does it have musical validity? Does its presence actually, does it need to be there? These are important questions. You have to constantly be asking yourself this, especially if you're not sure. You know, I mean, I've been in similar circumstances, but I always came to a point where I was like, I know that I'm done because this is too much. This is too much right here. You know, when you feel like you have to add more and more stuff to something, you're going too far in the wrong direction, or you may have actually started in the wrong direction to begin with. So you kind of have to chase your steps back and go like, okay, where did I take the left turn? You know, and really be honest with yourself the entire time. And the only thing at that point that you can rely on is your gut. That's the only thing. This is not any decision that can happen up here. It's completely in you. And you have to trust that. That's the only way to move forward.
And I think we have to leave it at that. Thank you, Michael.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
What's next?